Hello, anatomy colleagues. This is Dr. Alsup, and we are continuing our exploration of the musculoskeletal regional anatomy, starting superiorly and moving inferiorly, but focusing on the axial skeleton first. So that means we have reached the thorax region, and we are going to start with the discussion of the bones. And with the bones, we'll talk a little bit about the joints here. We won't have a separate video on the joints just because those costal cartilages and the connection between certain parts kind of lends itself to this discussion. And then, of course, we'll finish with the muscles. So we will talk about what we mean. Oops, I have muscles here that should say bones. I apologize. That was not updated. So we're talking bones here, and what's going to make up the thoracic cage? And we'll talk a little bit about what we mean by cage. And then we will talk about the main bones. So there'll be the sternum, or the breastbone, and the ribs. All right, so when we say the word thoracic cage, really what we're meaning here is the skeleton of the thoracic wall. And you can kind of see it's going to be these bones right in this region, and it will include the thoracic vertebrae as well, but we discussed that when we were talking about the back, so we're mainly going to focus on ribs and sternum here. So the thoracic cage is bony. When we say the word thoracic wall, this would include the muscles that extend between the ribs, so those intercostal muscles. So as you would probably guess, or you can think about what you had previous knowledge regarding, the thorax is going to protect organs. And that's one of the main functions of the thorax. It's going to protect the primary organs of respiration, so thinking about the lungs, the diaphragm will also extend into this area, as well as the cardiovascular system. But the inferior portions of the thoracic cage will also serve to protect some of the abdominal organs, some of the more superior abdominal organs. The cage will also resist negative or sub-atmospheric internal pressures. This is going to be generated by the elastic recoil of the lungs and that respiratory movement. So there's going to be movement in this area. And it will also be an important attachment site. So there will be attachment sites for muscles of the abdomen, the neck, the back, muscles of respiration. But it'll also provide kind of the anchoring attachment site, so it's the origin or the non-moving attachment of many of the muscles that will move or maintain the position of the upper limb. So the pectoralis major will have attachment here, its muscle belly will be located here, but its primary actions will be associated with the shoulder joint. So let's start anteriorly with the sternum. Sternum means chest. We often think of this as the breastbone or the chest plate. And this will directly overlie mediastinal viscera. And when we're talking about mediastinal viscera, one of the main things, particularly since the sternum is mostly in the midline, it's going to be covering or protecting much of the heart in particular. There will be three parts of the sternum. You will have the most superior portion, which is the manubrium, or the handle. The middle portion will be the body. It's the longest portion. And the most inferior portion will be the xiphoid process. And no xiphoid process looks alike. There's a considerable amount of variability in the xiphoid process, both in terms of size and shape. Excuse me, my voice is trying to give out on me. No, we got to talk about the sternum. So all three of these parts, they're going to articulate with one another, and they will be joined by synchondroses. So recall, synchondroses are a type of joint, a type of cartilaginous joint. Most of these joints will totally calcify, but they may not. Particularly between the manubrium and the body, sometimes that will not completely calcify. All right, a few structures that we want you to be able to identify on the sternum, and the majority of these are associated with the manubrium. The first will be the jugular notch, and I want you to kind of put your hand at the bottom, or put a finger at the bottom of your neck, and try to find your sternum. And one of the first things you'll probably feel is this divot right here, referred to as the jugular notch. This will be palpable. This is important in terms of palpating and getting an idea maybe of where you want to inject something, or where maybe you want to put a central line placement, because that can help you along the lines of the clavicle. And then just lateral to the jugular notches, you will have the clavicular notches. These aren't quite as easy to palpate, just because if you're feeling it on yourself, you'll have that clavicle there. So this is where the two clavicles are going to articulate with the manubrium. So these are the sternoclavicular joints. And lastly, right at where the manubrium meets the body is the sternal angle. And so if you're palpating, if you found your jugular notch and you continue to move inferiorly, you'll feel your sternum kind of project slightly more anterior than the rest of the sternum, and that is the sternal angle. And this is where your second rib, it's about at that level that the second rib will articulate with the sternum. So right around this region. And that helps in terms of counting ribs and getting an idea of at what level you are at in case there's any type of injury, or just understanding that. Also, both the jugular notch as well as the sternal angle will help in terms of guiding where a physician wants to put their stethoscope in order to hear specific sounds. All right, moving to ribs. There will be 12 pairs of ribs, or 24 ribs in all, and there are three main categories of ribs. Ribs 1 through 7, so if I'm kind of outlining these, 1 through 7 are referred to as true ribs, and the reason that they have this name is that each one of these will have their own costal cartilage that will articulate with the sternum. Right, so they will have their own costal cartilage connecting to the sternum. Many of these will have their articulation with the body of the sternum, some with the manubrium, some of the more superior ones. So the first through the seventh ribs are considered true ribs. The eighth and ninth and sometimes tenth rib will have an indirect connection to the sternum. So what happens is that the cartilage, say, associated with 8, so the costal cartilage here, will not go directly to the sternum because the sternum is too superior for that. So what will happen is it will just attach to the costal cartilage of the 7th rib and sometimes even into the 6th rib to indirectly articulate with the sternum. So you can see that here with the 9th and even with the 10th. So these are referred to as false ribs, but they're very, very much ribs. I think that's a little misleading of a name, but it's all about that indirect connection to the sternum. And lastly, the 11th and 12th, and sometimes 10th, but really you mostly see 11th and 12th, are called floating or free ribs because their cartilages do not connect to the sternums. There is cartilage on the ends of these ribs, but they do not articulate even with the more superior cartilages. So those are the free and floating ribs, and they are fairly nondescript in terms of shape. We'll look at another images, but you can see that most of the ribs are kind of curved. So they'll have their attachment on the vertebrae, which we'll talk about in a moment, and then they kind of curve around. There's not as much curvature when you're looking at the 11th and 12th ribs. Now, in between each of the ribs, you will have what's referred to as intercostal spaces. So this will separate the ribs and the costal cartilages. And the intercostal spaces are named according to the rib forming their superior border. So the space above the first rib is not an intercostal space. But if this is your first rib and this is your second rib, this would be the first intercostal space, and kind of so on as you move down, all right? this area where you have the kind of common costal cartilage that's heading towards the bottom portion or inferior portions of the sternum is referred to as the costal margin or the costal arch. And as costal cartilages are made up of cartilage, so will the costal margin. It will also be cartilage. And it's really these cartilages that are forming that joint between the ribs and the sternum. So it allows that movement that can occur with the thoracic cage. So we saw a lot of where the ribs articulate with the sternum, but the ribs also articulate with the vertebrae, specifically the thoracic vertebrae. All right, so that is one of the things, one of the reasons why we were able to identify a thoracic vertebrae is because they would have the facets where the head or the tubercle of the ribs would articulate. So the head of a rib will articulate with the body, whereas the tubercle, which is pretty close to, but a little distal to on the rib, will, the tubercle will articulate with the transverse process. And kind of understanding how those connect, for me, is always kind of conceptually difficult. So this image, I think, really shows pretty nicely how you have this region of the rib articulating with the vertebrae. Then it will kind of curve around and eventually make its way anteriorly with its costal cartilages to articulate with the sternum. Now, each rib is going to look a little different. Like I said, the 11th and 12th ribs are the... I will do that later. So those 11th and 12th ribs are fairly nondescript. They're not quite as curved. Whereas the first rib is unique in terms of its shape. It is broad, it is short, and it is very, very sharply curved. All right, so it has this very distinct curvature with the first rib. And if you kind of look at some of these other images, you can see that it's a little bit on the smaller side. Oftentimes it's even smaller than that 12th rib. But what is unique about the first rib, other than these things I just mentioned up here, is that it's a bit more rugose or robust in terms of muscle attachments. You will have both the anterior and the middle scalene muscles are attaching to this first rib, and those are those muscles that are going to be deeper in the neck. So you actually have that attaching to this first rib. So it will look a little bit more robust. You'll have a few more bumps associated with the first rib than you'll have in the other areas. Okay, so question time. The clavicle articulates with which part of the sternum? Is it the body? Is it the manubrium? Or is it the xiphoid process? And you kind of look at this picture to help guide you. And so kind of the keys to the stem here are clavicle articulating with sternum. And we know the clavicle is going to be kind of more superiorly placed. So it makes sense that I would articulate with the superiormost portion of the sternum, which would be the manubrium. So B is the correct answer. You do have articulations with the body and the xiphoid in the case of these costal cartilages, but the clavicle, this other bone here, will only articulate with the manubrium and that very, you know, uppermost or top portion of the manubrium at those clavicular notches. Okay, so our next video will focus on the intercostal muscles of the thoracic wall. And then we will continue our exploration of the rest of the regional anatomy. Thank you for your time and attention here, and have a great rest of your day.